I'd like to introduce Dr. Sohi Rastegar from the National Science Foundation, who's going to tell us about his emerging areas in research frontiers. I'm sure he'll get the name right. I didn't, but please.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here with you again this year. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the activities of Office of Emerging Frontiers in Research and Innovation. So the challenge that that we have been given is to find out what are the emerging frontiers in research and innovation. Here's a one slide description of EFRI. It was established in 2006 as an office to invest in important emerging areas. So the mission is very, very simple, actually. Important emerging areas in a timely manner. So it's those are the kinds of things that you know are the most difficult to do when the words are a few. So we set up a process to look for transformative ideas, ideas that deal with a national need or grand challenge. And one of the things that we looked at was what kind of a project are we looking for? What are the needs of the community, and what are the what are the gaps, if you like? So we noticed that there are NSF's mission, which is advancing discovery, education, and innovation. Most of the projects, as you know, are what we call single PI or two PI projects, roughly around $100,000 a year for 3 years. These are the typical bread and butter projects of NSF. And then we have centers, engineering research centers, which are fantastic interdisciplinary activities for research, education, and technology transfer. So there was a gap in between having small groups of people coming and pushing new ideas and focusing only on research. So that was one of the first thing we determined, that that's the kind of project we want to focus on. Then we looked at higher risk and higher reward projects. So another option was to go completely unsolicited, which we still can. We haven't tried it. We consult our advisory committee twice a year whether or not to go that route, and they haven't told us to do that yet. So we took an alternative route of identifying topic areas that are emerging and important. First, we started doing this activity within NSF, within the engineering directorate. We have about 60 to 70 PhDs. They're all very well aware of the topic areas. Each one of them deals with a portfolio of 100 to 150 projects, so they know communities. About 40% of the folks are professors such as yourself who a little bit more advanced in their career, who rotate in and out of NSF and bring in ideas. So there's lots of great ideas. So we experimented with exploring topic areas, important topic areas within on the floor itself. And then after a couple of years, we realized that the process works, and we opened it up to the community. So we have been receiving ideas, one-pagers. We put out a Dear Colleague letter. We asked the community to send us their ideas, what they think is an emerging topics. And that's the catch here, is to look for topics that are not exploratory, but they're emerging. That is, there is a burgeoning community that's coming out for which there is no program at NSF. So that's really the gap we're trying to fill. So it's like a prototype program, if you like. And these are the list of topics that we have looked at since 2007. Autonomously reconfigurable engineered system, cellular biomolecular engineering, cognitive optimization, resilient and sustainable infrastructures, biosensing and bioactuation, hydrocarbon from biomass, science in engineering and environmental design, engineering sustainable buildings, which is one of your topics this year, renewable energy storage, engineering multicellular and interkingdom signaling, which is we just made eight awards in that direction. The awards will be announced later this week. Mind machine and motor control, M3C. These are the topics that we've done through 2011, and we've just opened up a competition for 2012 with three topic areas, and I'll tell you what they are in a minute. So the community puts in their idea. For last year, for example, we received about 120 one-pagers from the community. And furthermore, we engaged experts from the community in sifting through these ideas. We brought in venture capitals, experts from other countries, experts from government, experts from that are not involved with any of these projects from some of the universities in the US. So we brought them in. We engaged the program directors themselves on the floor. So we went through a pretty elaborate process in order to identify what the important topics are. A lot of these ideas are great ideas. So we continue to seek your input for those ideas. The next opportunity for input is going to be 2014. For 2012 and 13, we have already completed the cycle of topic selection. So I've already told you the criteria we're looking for, and interdisciplinary is an important criteria for this program as well. We also juxtapose these projects with respect to NAE grant challenges. And as you can see, a great majority of them deal with many of the grand challenges identified by the National Academy of Engineering. We have a few ideas in the bottom right that go beyond those grand challenges, deal with other ideas. For instance, what I've labeled green, which are the topics, for instance, seed and restore. Seed is the topic for you today. And are in those arena, but we also have hydrocarbon from biomass, which is the idea of alternative energy. Or the topics for this year, I'll tell you in a minute, photosynthetic biorefineries. Or this one, multicellular and interkingdom signaling, has impact on better medicine, but it also has an impact on biotechnology and on energy. For instance, one project in MIX that we funded this year on interkingdom signaling is to take advantage of termites, understanding the organisms in termite gut and manipulating those so that you can use those to break down lignocellulose in the photosynthetic process, and so in the photosynthetic refinery process. So that's one of, to give you an idea of what ideas it opened when we went to the direction of interkingdom signaling, which is a well-understood, well-studied topic in biology, but engineers are just getting into it. So we brought biologists and engineers to work on those. For seed, you're going to hear quite a bit about that. Our idea was to bring architects and engineers together and social and behavioral scientists and really address important issues on sustainable buildings. We funded those last year. So for the topics this year, the three topics, flexible bioelectronic systems for medical applications, or BioFlex, origami design for integration of self-assembly systems for engineering innovation, or Odyssey, and photosynthetic biorefineries, PSBR, are the three topics we picked for this year. We partner with Air Force Office of Scientific Research, as well as other directorates of NSF in this activity. Important information regarding these. We will have a webcast in 2 days, actually. You can go to the EFRI website and sign up for it if you have the time. It's going to be 3 in the afternoon Eastern time. And the end of September is letters of intent, required letters of intent. If you have an idea and want to submit a pre-proposals, and pre-proposals are due November 9. And full proposals will be invited for at the end of March. So these are the important dates. I wanted to also make a remark about the kinds of project. We did a study, extensive study of assessment of the EFRI processes last year externally. And one of the things we had them do is look at the interdisciplinarity of the projects. They looked at both transformative, potentially transformative nature of the projects and interdisciplinarity of the project. And what they found, so that you, it's a clue for you, the kinds of projects that were successful, is in the next slide. Everyone is familiar with the global map of science. Anyone who doesn't know this. So this is just one way. They have organized different fields of science and engineering in this visual way. So what they did was they looked at, this is for biosensing and bioactuation project, but it was more or less true for most of the projects. So what you see there on the top row is the lead PI's focus area, where his or her publications were. So you can see, for instance, it's dominated in this area. The other one is dominated in these area. And so you can see get an idea. These are three of the projects, and we are not identified which ones they are. And then they also examine the proposals that came. And if you look at this, for instance, the PI, even though his or her expertise was in this area, you can barely see it here. So what they did was they partnered with 3 or 4 other experts, and they wrote a fantastic proposal that was funded. They did not focus necessarily on their own research area. They focused on the project. And that's a very important lesson. What is it that you want to accomplish? What is it that is important that needs to be accomplished, rather than saying, what can I do? What is needed to be done? You figure that out, and then you assemble your team, and you make a successful proposal. That's how successful interdisciplinary proposals in EFRI look like. So that was a little message that I got from this examination. And I stop right here. Couple of minutes for question, or we can stop and give you back some time.
It's refreshing to hear somebody emphasize this theme of choosing the problem rather than being sort of a solution looking for a problem, which is all too common these days. We sort of over-specialize and get good at something and then become sort of a round peg trying to ram in a square hole whenever we see a proposal call. And it's something that's really problematic. I would generalize the theme a little further, and I would say this. In certain areas like energy, where the problems are so challenging, you know, witness how little progress has been made since 1973, the oil shock of 73, in terms of real progress and game-changing technologies. What that tells you is it's not that there's a lack of ideas around, it's that there's a lack of really good ideas around.
Exactly.
And you never know where, especially in something that's highly interdisciplinary, where those ideas may come up. And so I would say beware of being overly prescriptive of setting up kind of a topic du jour type of thing, where if somebody comes up with a great innovation, they're going to get a response, well, that doesn't fit into this year's solicitation. very problematic. And it's hard to run a program like that because people would say, well, you need focus. But it's important to remember focus in and of itself is not an end.
Yeah, that's, you know, there are two camps. So we hear both your idea, and we also hear ideas from others that if we completely make this unsolicited, then we're going to get 2,000 proposals, and the funding rate is going to be so bad that people are going to be very disappointed. So that's why we sort of this topically driven path was chosen, so that we say, okay, we're going to take a risk and do it in these two, three topics, and see what happens. But NSF has other opportunities as well for what you're pointing out. For exploratory ideas, you can always submit what is called EAGR proposal. It's exploratory grant for something, EAGR. I can't even. And then in the next few weeks, you're going to hear something about that the Director Suresh has come up with, called INSPIRE, Interdisciplinary Support for Interdisciplinary Research and Education. And you're going to get the opportunity to submit proposals for up to $1 million for exactly the kinds of ideas that you just mentioned. And so the details of that is going to be in the Dear Colleague letter, so I cannot tell you too much about it. I can tell you that there is such an activity because it's in the 2012 budget. He has disclosed it, so I can tell you that there is going to be a program. So in a few weeks, you're going to get the Dear Colleague letter that's going to open up opportunities for those kinds of ideas that you mentioned. But I do appreciate your thanks. Sometimes we write down, okay, we want these elements to be included in your proposal. That's a way of us narrowing down a little bit the number of proposals that come in. That may limit, sometimes it may limit some good ideas. But we have also violated that. People have submitted it, and it was a great idea. The panelist says great, and we've gone ahead with it.
All right,
thank you.